Good evening and welcome to this evening's forum. I'm Rabbi Jonah Steinberg. I am the director of Harvard Hillel and a chaplain in the university. And if I do nothing else up here this evening, what I must do is invite you to silence your now outmoded iPhone 5s and other digital devices. But I do have a few more tasks, pleasant and if ceremonial. One is to welcome you all here on behalf of Harvard Hillel, as well as our partners in this evening, Harvard University's Center for Middle Eastern Studies and Department of Near Eastern Languages and Civilizations. And I'm welcoming you to our first annual Riesman Forum on Politics and Policy, Turbulent Summer and Update on the Middle East. This evening's program reflects the commitment of Harvard Hillel always, and especially as we return from this very eventful summer, to foster intelligent and informed conversation befitting this great university. And when it comes to viewing the Middle East today from where we sit tonight in North America, and from a perspective of international relations, we could hardly have a more distinguished panel than we do this evening, and I'm grateful to our panelists, about whom you'll hear more in just a moment. I'm also glad and honored to acknowledge the presence with us tonight of His Excellency the Consul General of Turkey, who will be returning to Turkey, as I understand, in just about a fortnight's time. So I'm very glad that you can be with us this evening. And I am delighted to welcome so many friends of Harvard Hillel, including the Dean of Undergraduate Education, Jay Harris, and more about others who are here, especially up here in a moment. But let me take a moment as we begin this evening to acknowledge two people who are fellow architects and builders of this forum. First of all, our moderator this evening, Professor Noah Feldman, who has done a great deal to assemble this dream team of a panel. And also my colleague Miriam May, who has done, is doing so much even as I speak to bring us to this evening and to other occasions and events that are rapidly approaching. Not least among them, our second kosher tailgate at the upcoming Harvard-Yale game. Stay tuned for that, and for more serious things too. I'll come back to say something about Noah in a moment, and Noah will say something about our other panelists. But first, it is my great pleasure and honor to introduce a fundamental builder of this evening and a member of Harvard's class of 1940, and as I learned this evening, an entryway mate of John F. Kennedy in F entryway, I think, in Winthrop House, Mr. Bill Berman, a supporter of Hillel and of Jewish life here at Harvard and in Michigan, and of worthy causes far and wide, who will dedicate this evening's program and Harvard Hillel's annual Riesman Forum on Politics and Policy in memory of his late classmate and a namesake of Harvard Hillel, Robert Riesman. Mr. Berman.
Thank you. The mic is right in front of me. Good. Thank you for allowing me to say a word or two. I love Bob Riesman. He lived, let's see, we're both Harvard 40. Bob lives in Adams House, me in Winthrop House. And we didn't know each other too well during those college years, although I might have read something that Bob would have written for either the Crimson or the Globe. But I met Bob later in the 80s, and we began to travel around the world together. And he was an amazing guy. If there was a Renaissance man, and I don't know what that word really means, but to me, it articulated what that man was. I knew him, of course, as a friend, a travel companion, a guy we had fun with. I'll come back in a moment to what Bob turned out to be. We met and traveled, like some stories, quick ones. I've only got about 4 minutes or something. But Bob and I remember went to up the Nile together. And I had lost my luggage. And what do you do for dinner. Well, Bob knew right away. He said, come to the laundry with me. We did, and there he had me searching for an appropriate shirt and a pair of pants, which we found. I still have the shirt, by the way. This was 30 years ago. And Bob dressed me up in the pants and the shirt, and then the big issue was, would the guy who owned the pants and the shirt discover us in the dining room? Only Riesman worry about that, and we did. I remember traveling with Bob further into Kenya, and we passed a group of lions eating a zebra. And our heads were sticking out of this cart. You know, you've all done this, and many of you, I hope. And we passed some lions eating the zebra. We moved on further, and there was a bunch of zebras. Bob said, stop the car. I said, good God, why, Bob? He said, because to tell the family where they're holding memorial services. Now, only Riesman could think like that. I loved him because at night he'd recite Shakespeare's sonnets to me. I never knew anybody who would say Shakespeare's sonnets. I'm Harvard College, Harvard Business School. I became a big merchant builder. What did I know about Shakespeare's sonnets? Only Riesman could do that. I loved the guy because of who he was, what he was to me. And I mentioned the Shakespeare sonnets because it affects me so much. But he gave me something that I never had. And we traveled together and he affected my life. And so I'm very proud tonight that I can, as I have done, make a gift to Harvard Hillel so that for the next 10 years, at least 10 years, there will be a Riesman foreign policy seminar. And I know Bob would have loved it. And I come from Detroit tonight to honor Bob. And I think that he would have loved to have been, to have known that would be a seminar of this kind in the years ahead for him. Let me take a moment now because Bob Riesman Jr. has joined us from Chicago, and I come from Detroit, as you know. So Bob, a word or two about your dad.
Bill, on behalf of the Riesman family, I want to thank you, your wife Madge, and the Berman Foundation for establishing the Riesman Forum in my father's honor. I know how much he cherished his friendship with you, a connection that spanned nearly 8 decades. And I know how much it would mean to him to have his name associated with a lecture series at Harvard that is dedicated to substantive discussions of politics and policy. I also know how pleased my father would be that Harvard Hillel is the institution within Harvard that is presenting the Riesman Forum. He always spoke with pride and gratitude about his years as an undergraduate at Harvard. His collegiate experience played a significant role in defining the exacting standards to which he held himself in all his pursuits. It also expanded the range of subjects to which he directed his restless and probing intellectual curiosity. But it was a set of events that took place thousands of miles away during his junior year that brought his commitment to Jewish causes to the forefront of his values. When my father arrived on campus as a freshman in 1936, as he later described it, there was virtually no communal Jewish presence at Harvard. This changed abruptly in November 1938 when reports reached Cambridge of the vicious and widespread attacks on Jews in Germany during Kristallnacht. The news galvanized my father and other Jewish students into forming a small group to gather petitions and to meet with one of the deans. In describing himself and his newly assembled colleagues, my father observed that our Jewish education had, in effect, stopped with our bar mitzvah, but we were very much aware of our identity. The group's request was for Harvard to invite a Jewish professor living in Germany and whose life and career were both at risk there to come to Harvard to teach. When the dean turned down the group's plea, my father's dismay with the decision was heightened by his awareness of the marginalized status of the Jewish community at Harvard. Over the next several decades, my father served in the armed forces in World War II, married my mother, a union that lasted 58 years, and rose to executive positions in several successful businesses, starting with his family business. At the same time, he was devoting his formidable energies on a regular basis to numerous Jewish community boards and organizations, both in Rhode Island and nationally. He also became very active in Democratic Party politics, both locally and nationally, chairing or co-chairing numerous political campaigns. Then, sometime in the mid-1970s, my father learned that the leadership of Harvard Hillel was considering the possibility of relocating from its then current and fairly run-down home to a newly constructed building, which would be much closer to Harvard Yard. This was a project that resonated for him in a unique set of ways. In fact, it is hard to imagine an initiative that could have engaged him more than one offering him a chance to play a meaningful role in establishing Harvard Hillel as a significant presence at Harvard. Once he committed to support this ambitious fundraising campaign, he joined an equally determined and energetic group of colleagues. And so, in September 1979, the opening ceremony for the Riesman Center for Harvard Radcliffe Hillel on Mount Auburn Street was held. The building dedication marked the beginning of a new era for Jewish life at Harvard. Among those in attendance were three generations of my family, including my father's parents, Joseph and Sadie Riesman, who fastened the mezuzah to the doorposts of the new building. The dean of the Faculty of Arts and Sciences of Harvard University, Henry Rosofsky, was the featured speaker. The extraordinary journey that Harvard Hillel had made was compactly described by the title of his address, From Periphery to Center, the Changing Jewish Presence at Harvard. For my father and his contemporaries, and for all those who had worked tirelessly to make the vision of the building a reality, it was the achievement of a goal that 40 years prior, in my father's phrase, would have seemed sheer fantasy. Bill, by establishing the Riesman Forum, you have expanded significantly the potential impact and visibility of the programs offered by Harvard Hillel. It is precisely the kind of bold initiative that my father hoped that Harvard Hillel might someday undertake. Thank you for conceiving and initiating such a wonderfully fitting way to honor his life and legacy.
At Noah's request, I'll be very brief, especially because we want to get to our panel. But I'll just say that although there may be many academics who can sympathize metaphorically speaking, there are not all that many who have actually come under sniper fire, the real kind with bullets in the line of scholarly duty. Our friend Noah Feldman has that distinction among many, many others. That happened when he was serving as senior constitutional advisor to the Provisional Authority in Iraq. Since then, he has written What We Owe Iraq, War and the Ethics of Nation Building, and After Jihad, America and the Struggle for Islamic Democracy, as well as Scorpions, the Battles and Triumphs of FDR's Great Supreme Court Justices, speaking of whom Noah is the Felix Frankfurter Professor of Law here at Harvard and a senior fellow of Harvard Society of Fellows. And thank you so much for moderating our program this evening, Noah.
Thank you very much, Jonah. Thank you all very much for coming. I thought I would start with a little quiz.
Spaceship.
I have beside me the Jean Kirkpatrick Professor. I have the Edward R. Murrow Professor. And I have the Sultan of Oman Professor. So you have to guess which professor goes with which person, and that's your opening responsibility. The three panelists whom we have here are all really extraordinary people with remarkable accomplishments, and I'm going to diminish just by duration each of their accomplishments in introducing them in the interests of time. But I will tell you how I picked them, which is that when I was an undergraduate, I was very involved in Harvard Hillel, and one of my responsibilities was to do planning of programs on the Middle East and Israel. And so the way I thought of this program is exactly the way I thought of that program, those programs, which is that I just asked all of the best people in the university if they would do it. The difference between being an undergraduate and now is that they all said yes. So that was a very pleasant and good thing. To my immediate left, Meghan O'Sullivan. Yeah, I'm not going to tell you which professor she is. You'll have to figure that out. Meghan and I met when we were in Iraq, I for about 15 minutes and Meghan for 2 years. I may occasionally have been near sniper fire, but Meghan was actually attacked by long-range rockets in the Rashid Hotel. During her time there, she rose through the ranks of the Coalition Provisional Authority and ended up as the lead advisor to Ambassador Paul Bremer, who was running the CPA, and then to Robert Blackwell, who came out from Washington to work on it. She then went back to Washington, where she was a senior director in the National Security Council, and from there became the deputy national security advisor for Iraq and Afghanistan. That is the Iraq-Afghanistan czar. She was the founding czar, if there can be such a thing.
Czarina,
forgive me. Which means that she briefed the President of the United States daily during her multiple years in this position, and she was the policy architect of the surge in Iraq, of which David Petraeus was the military architect. We are extraordinarily fortunate to have her here. Her knowledge of Iraq, of Afghanistan, of Kurdistan, and of the region generally is unparalleled and remarkable. To her left, Nicholas Burns spent 27 years as a career officer in the United States State Department. He was an ambassador to Greece. He was ambassador to NATO. He was Undersecretary of State for Political Affairs, which is the third highest position in the State Department. Of his many responsibilities in these positions, they included running the Iran nuclear negotiations, a topic which I hope we'll have an opportunity to speak about tonight. And he, like Meghan, is a professor at the Kennedy School, where each of them coordinates and runs a broad range of fascinating and important programs. They're also both members of essentially every organization known to man, including my personal favorite, the Trilateral Commission. So if there are any paranoids in the audience tonight, you can begin with that fact.
Red Sox Nation.
And Red Sox Nation, which is, after all, the organization to which we all belong.
Exactly.
Last and very much not least is Michael Ignatieff at the far end of the table. When you mentioned that Bob Riesman was a Renaissance man, you stole my introduction for Michael. There is literally a little picture of Michael when you look up Renaissance man in the dictionary. Trained as a historian, he has been a journalist for print, a journalist for television, a biographer, a novelist, and a professor, a scholar, and most recently, the leader of the Liberal Party in Canada and a candidate for prime minister in our neighbor to the north. If that's not a Renaissance career, I don't know what is. And he's capped it off most recently by writing a philosophical book about being a politician. And I think we can pretty much guarantee that in our lifetime, no one else will be able to write such a book. Michael is also an expert on human rights. He's traveled broadly in the Middle East and indeed broadly everywhere, and we're very, very fortunate to have him here as well. Okay, no more introductions, no more preliminaries. You're all ready for substance, here we go. So let me start, Meghan, by asking you about the main turbulence in the headlines, at least, which is the series of events that led ISIS or ISIL or the Islamic State, I'd be actually curious to see which terminology you prefer, into Iraq. So tell us, if you would, a little bit about how you think that happened and what you think it means for Iraq.
Sure. And first, let me just say what a pleasure it is to be here tonight and to be at this forum. The situation in Iraq really grabbed everyone's attention in June when you had ISIS, which I'll use the Sham rather than Levant, when ISIS took over Iraq's second largest city, which is Mosul. And that really grabbed people's attention. But for those of us who had been watching, or you know, more so if you were living in Iraq, this permeation of ISIS into Iraq had been going on and was very clear for the previous 8 or 10 months. And you can attribute it to a number of factors, but for the interest of kind of time and simplicity, I'll kind of put it down to essentially three things. And the most important one, I would say, is the situation in Syria. That basically you had a lot of the people who were eventually pushed out of Iraq in 2008 and 2009 go into Syria. And I remember at the time, you know, thinking that a lot of their real interest lay back in Iraq. And so when you had the deterioration in Syria, that put a lot of pressure on the Iraqi state. And then the second issue that kind of opened up space for ISIS in Iraq was the Iraqi government itself. and the policies of Prime Minister Maliki, which we could get into, you may be familiar with. But he really, in part because he was paranoid about kind of the Muslim Brotherhood, he started pushing Sunnis out of his government and narrowing the political space, which was something that had been really hard fought for over the course of the 10 years previously. So you had extremism coming in and sectarianism from Syria. You had kind of polarization of Iraq's politics and marginalization of the Sunnis. And you had this in the context of the third issue, which I would call just the US departure, which is at the end of 2011. And what's really key there, and really key to understanding why Mosul fell so quickly, is that there are many reasons why an American military presence might have had some stabilizing effects. But the one that I kind of think of the most is that that allowed us to really have some eyes on what was happening in the Iraqi military. And in the Iraqi military, we constantly had pressure from the prime minister. When I say we, I'm using kind of a US government speak. But the prime minister was constantly wanting to remove kind of career people in the Iraqi military and replace them with political partisans. And when we left, that became doable without any pushback. And so all the times that numerous diplomats or President Bush or others would call up Maliki and say, look, you can't just replace Sunni commanders with your friends. You know, there was suddenly no pushback on that. So over time, you had a degradation of the Iraqi military and really a sectarianism in the military. And so when you had the challenge, when you had this confrontation between ISIS and the Iraqi military, a lot of those in the Iraqi military said, why am I going to fight and possibly die for a state which has marginalized me politically? And I don't respect or have confidence in the people who are leading me. And those two things kind of get us to that moment, and then I think the rest of the world kind of comes back into the story, because then we start to see a real and massive deterioration of the security situation in Iraq, and only really in August with the intervention of the United States and the Kurdish forces into the fight do we see kind of a pushback.
Nicholas, can I ask you, just to following from that, about the problem of leverage? So the United States made a big point in the aftermath of the fall of Mosul, that we didn't want to help at all until Maliki was out. And Meghan wrote a piece saying, great idea, never going to happen, because we don't have the leverage to pull it off. That's an oversimplification.
Never going to happen, not that he's never going to be out, but that we can't hold off until he gets removed before we take any decisive action.
Right, and that seemed mostly, I would say 95% of the case was to be true. So how does a country generate leverage under circumstances like this?
Well, thank you. And since I almost always agree with Meghan, I did agree with the op-ed that she wrote. I want to say first, thank you to the Riesman family. And it's a great honor to be here in the inaugural Riesman Forum. And thank you to Harvard Hillel. It's a real honor to be here. Emerson's one of my heroes, and I've never been in Emerson Hall.
Wow.
So
that's cool.
Happy to be here. Nora, let me say this. You're right to focus on leverage. And we gave up a lot of leverage with the complete departure of the American forces at the end of 2011. But we've now reinserted ourselves as the primary outside actor. And we've had to do that for the following obvious reason. This is the most consequential set of American interests now in the Middle East, the Iraq-Syria war. And you can't think of the Iraq war without thinking of the war in Syria. Because the consequences are, of course, Syria has been largely destroyed, the infrastructure. 9 million of the 22 million people are refugees. There's not a single country in the world with that high a proportion of its population without homes, without jobs, on the run. That war has now bled into Iraq. And as Meghan said, when Mosul was taken just a couple of months ago, that represented an ominous warning for us that Iraq might be dismembered. It might split into three parts. It might split into more. And with that kind of trouble, these are keystone states. In Levant, think of the implications for Lebanon, we're already seeing that, for Jordan, for Turkey. Think of the implications for the northern border of Israel, for all of you who've been up to the Golan Heights to look into Syria. And so the president's going to give an address tomorrow night, and he needs to build up our leverage. And I think he needs to do three or four things, which I think he will do. The White House has been talking about the emergence of an ISIS policy, ISIS-Syria policy, which to me sounds quite sensible. If we, number one, continue the American airstrikes, because it's making a great tactical difference, because we prevented ISIS from taking Erbil and from getting into Iraqi Kurdistan. And Kurdistan, Meghan knows a lot more about Iraq than I do, but that's a vital interest. for the United States. Number two, we need a ground force, because nobody believes we can be successful across 2 or 3 years, and it's going to be a long campaign. We're going to have patience and some will. We need a ground force. It won't be the United States. This president and this Congress won't commit substantial American military forces back into Iraq. So the ground forces have to be the Peshmerga, the Kurdish forces, a reconstituted Iraqi army, and perhaps Syrian rebel groups that we should arm aggressively, those rebel groups hostile to ISIS, which has its base in northern Syria. And number three, this is what we don't know what the president's going to say tomorrow night or whether he's ready to take this step. If you do those two things, if you continue the airstrikes, which basically freezes ISIS geographically in western Iraq and northern Syria, if you arm and train these rebel, the Peshmerga and the Iraqis to be our ground force, do you then strike into Syria itself through air power to degrade ISIS at its home base of support? And do you arm those rebel groups in a way the administration has never done to try to level the playing field in Syria itself? That's going to be a risk. That could go quickly wrong for the United States, but the president, I think, is being pushed by some of his advisors to go there. Last thing I'd say, and forgive the length of this, the key question that he needs to talk to us about tomorrow night is, what is our strategic aim? Nietzsche said the most common form of human stupidity is forgetting what we're trying to do, which in government, I recognize that from my experience in government. I'm sure that Meghan and Michael do as well. Are we trying to contain ISIS or destroy it and defeat it? Because you walk down very different roads if you're containing, and we've only been containing the last 2 months, versus defeat and destruction. Defeat and destruction, if we look at what Meghan and I went through in Afghanistan, for instance, what Meghan went through, I did not work on Iraq, Meghan did in Iraq, it will take years. It will take billions of dollars. It will take a major American commitment. And if the coalition is only the United States, the UK, and France, it will fail. It needs Arab buy-in. It needs Saudi, Emirati, and Kuwaiti, as well as Turkish Muslim buy-in.
So there's, I just want to follow up on that. I mean, I think that was an extraordinarily cogent analysis, but it very tactfully never mentioned the buy-in of Bashar al-Assad, because our position, at least formally, has been that he must go, whatever exactly that means. But of course, he's the natural ground force in the game. He can't be our stated ground force, obviously, but the person with the strongest natural and immediate local interest in defeating ISIS, who has an army on the ground, is not the rebels against Assad, but Assad himself. Now, eventually that will lead us back to a conversation about Iran, but I really just want to ask, you know, whither Assad in this whole picture? I mean, if we bomb in Syria against Assad's enemies, and let's make no mistake about it, ISIS is, you know, is Assad's enemy, then de facto, we are the best thing that's ever happened to Bashar al-Assad.
Well, I mean, this is messy and complicated. And every choice...
Welcome to the Middle East, yeah.
Welcome to the... And every choice the president is going to make, and I have enormous sympathy for him in trying to make these choices, is going to have unintended consequences or intended consequences we're not going to feel good about.
Yeah.
But I'd say this, Noah. There's no question if we strike at ISIS and weaken it, we're helping Assad. But we shouldn't align ourselves with him. He's a major human rights violator. He's a vicious autocrat. The president is on the record saying he must go. His allies are our adversaries, Iran, Hezbollah, and Russia. And if we triangulate to the Ukraine-Russia crisis and triangulate to the Iran nuclear negotiations, we shouldn't be, as a matter of policy, trying to help the Iranians and help the Russians at a time we're trying to leverage, to use your word, Iran at the negotiating table in Vienna, and Russia in Europe. And so there will be these consequences, but we don't have to align ourselves with these nefarious actors.
Michael, I want to follow up by asking you about the use of force and the question of morality might be the wrong word, but ethics and morality. You and I both, you in a very leading way and I in a much more minor way, were deeply interested in the question in the run-up to the Iraq War of the morality of the use of force and the question of human rights. Here, what seems to have at least politically authorized U.S. bombing in Iraq of ISIL targets or ISIS targets was at least nominally a human rights crisis with respect to various groups of people, actually. I mean, in the U.S., the main emphasis publicly was on the Yazidis, but actually in Europe, the greater public emphasis was on the Assyrian and Chaldean Christians who are also being threatened by ISIS. So there's some sense that we may be back to the races again, you know, that maybe some of the lessons that we learned with respect to Iraq are now back in the picture. And I wanted to ask you to ruminate on that.
It's a great question, which is what you say when you're playing for time. I was struck by a remark I read in the press recently, which someone said, you know, the President of the United States, President Obama, gave the country, the United States, what it wanted. Get out of foreign wars. Don't do stupid stuff. Don't use the military instrument as your first instrument of policy. He gave the country what the country wanted, and the United States is looking at it now and doesn't like it at all. The pendulum does appear to be swinging in some way, but it's only swinging partly. As Nick Burns said, there is no support anywhere in the United States for recommitting ground troops to these issues. There is strong support for humanitarian relief of the kind that you're talking about on Mount Sinjar. And the ethical basis for, to get to the question you asked, the ethical basis for rescuing the Yazidis, who I know a little bit and I've visited, and the Christian communities, the Turkmens, the Assyrians, is overwhelmingly strong, the moral case for it. But it's highly ironic that it's the United States that seems to be caring about the centuries-old multicultural fabric of Ottoman Middle East. And as it disintegrates, the only remaining protector of those minorities happens to be the wicked old imperialist United States. So there are a full set of ironies here. The thing to add to the humanitarian picture always is that humanitarian motive alone is never strong enough to compel states to act. We did what we had to do with our allies on Mount Sinjar because it was just evidently a humanitarian pressure on the conscience of the West. But we will stay engaged with this for strategic reasons. And then the politics of humanitarianism is to hold all those minorities on our side. Any strategy against ISIS has to understand, as I think Meghan was implying, that these people are making a lot of enemies, and we need to make friends with their enemies, the religious minorities that are threatened, the Kurds whose very existence is threatened. Then we have the difficult question about how much you make friends with Mr. Assad, and Nick is absolutely right. We can't touch that with a 10-foot pole for moral reasons as well as geopolitical reasons.
But we shouldn't forget that he too is a member of a religious minority. I mean, the response of the Syrian regime would be, you know, the Alawis are themselves a religious minority, and that's why they're threatened by ISIL the same way the Yazidis are. I mean, I'm not defending the Syrian position, but I am describing it, ventriloquizing it, and it's not totally absurd.
Yes, that's the case that a brutal authoritarian dictator does make, but we've got to stay a long way clear of that. I also don't think that Assad is going to give us any help. When we talk about what troops have you got, to the question that Nick raised, which is an excellent one, do you contain or defeat ISIL? The question is, you can contain them with air power, you can only defeat them with ground forces, and you've identified who those ground forces might be. And then the question would be, are Assad's ground forces part of that picture? I don't somehow see that. He's just lost four military bases in the desert. So we're stuck with a Peshmerga, and we're stuck with a Shia in the south. And my concern is that, and this gets back to your moral question, once you make a commitment to not contain ISIL but defeat them, you're committing yourself to ground operations of some kind. A principal then has to engage agents to conduct the ground operations. What agents have we got here? The Peshmerga will fight for Kurdistan, but they're not going to fight, it seems to me, to get rid of ISIL in Iraq. They're going to fight for their own territory. the Shia in the South will fight to protect their holy shrines and protect what's theirs. But I'm still not seeing the strategy that defeats them. The one thing that I would think Meghan would know much more about than I do, that the key dimension here is not just the military side, but the diplomatic side. Unless we can squeeze these Gulf states and the really terrible support that the Saudis, the Gulf states, you know, 40 years of this kind of Wahhabist extremism, now really it's come home to roost. And we've been allied with some terrible people there. And unless we can begin to squeeze that political side, the ideological side, I don't see how we can do anything other than contain. So bottom line, I can't see humanitarian reasons to be engaged, but only strategic reasons will keep us involved. And if unless we can find ground forces to do the work, ISIL is there for a long time.
Meghan, all roads lead back to Kurdistan and to you here.
I want to draw a comparison in part just to inject a little bit of what is dangerous to do. I'm not a military person, but kind of reality about the relative strength of some of the forces we're talking about. And this is, again, my own personal opinion, but I think if we are to come under the impression that we can contain ISIS as it is by some tactical bombing and arming the Kurds and trying to build up the Iraqi army over the long term, I think we're kidding ourselves. We've heard from every US intelligence and defense official over the last few weeks that ISIS is a much more formidable opponent than AQI, Al-Qaeda in Iraq, was. And some of us, you know, remember how brutal an opponent AQI was. And we also remember that we were fighting, or the Iraqis were fighting AQI with more than 100,000 US soldiers on the ground, working with them, embedded with them, arming them, helping coordinate their strikes, doing nightly counterterrorism strikes on their leadership. So I think in some ways our national conversation, not here, but our national conversation is talking about that as a viable option, where I think, you know, my instinct is, I know we're on camera and on the record, but that is not going to be sufficient, and it is certainly not a medium-term strategy. And of course, we're faced with an immediate crisis, and so we need to deal with the immediacy of the moment. But we also have to think about, you know, where, as Nick said, where do we want to go? What's the strategic objective here? And that gets us into this very unfortunate question about, well, do we do something that actually has a short-term advantage of, or disadvantage of helping Assad, but or the short-term advantage of getting at this immediate threat, but perhaps a medium and longer-term advantage of helping Assad? And, you know, my response, and I'm sure you'll both agree, is, you know, welcome to the world of policymaking. You know, you get two bad options, and you get to choose between them. And I think that one of the things we've been leaving out of the conversation thus far is a ground force, which is the Sunni Iraqis. We've been talking about the Sunnis in Syria. We've been talking about the Shia in Iraq and the Kurds. And we actually have a population that's living under ISIS right now that has approached the U.S. on multiple occasions saying, you know, we're ready to fight, but we need to know that we're going to have support. And it's one of the things that I've heard from Iraqi Sunnis over the last few months. Great, you're willing to help the Shia-dominated Iraqi government. Great, you're willing to help the Kurds. But, you know, what are you willing to do for us? So I think there are multiple actors here. And when we look at the Syrian picture, we also just, you know, need to keep in mind we would be helping Assad, but we'd also be helping another force that's fighting Assad, because there's at least three sides to this war, maybe more, in Syria. And so the question is, you know, can you build up something that will resemble a Syrian military institution over the longer term? I think that's, you know, it's a little bit of a hard argument, and as you were saying, it's a long-term sell. But I think that we have to think about what a Middle East where we just try to contain this problem is going to end up looking like.
But can I just want to push even beyond that, and this is for anybody who wants to jump in on it. You know, there's the question of what happens in Syria. Let's assume containment of ISIS only insofar as it's no longer dominant in Western Iraq. That's, as you say, it's a heroic assumption. But let's just even make that assumption. That still leaves totally unresolved the question of what happens in Syria. And of course, it's in large part, as you were all saying, the way things have been stuck in Syria over the last several years that generated the capacity for ISIS to then move in the direction of Iraq. So what's your vision for what Syria could plausibly come to look like over the next year or two? Because if it continues, or even the next 5 years, if it continues in this kind of nether world which it's in, where Assad does not have sufficient opposition to come down, but is also, but the opponents don't have enough aid to take him down, this will just continue.
Mm-hmm. I think our strategic framework has to be, in the president's a very realistic person, that in the largest dimension, we're 3.5 years out from the Arab revolutions. In the 22 Arab countries, exactly one is better off, Tunisia.
Yep.
You cannot make a case that any of the others are better off. In fact, they're mostly worse off. I think we have to assume that we will have limited influence across the Middle East, and we'll have limited capacity, given the political will here, given the fact that we're in the wake of two big land wars ourselves, to act. And that we might want to assume years of violence and a revolutionary cycle playing itself out. That's the strategic framework. Mm-hmm. If you narrow it a little bit on Syria, you're exactly right to go to Syria. The president has been avoiding any kind of action in Syria. And of course, he got us out of Iraq. That's why he ran for president in 2008. And in a Shakespearean kind of way, he is inevitably now being dragged back into it. He has no option but to go in front of the American people tomorrow night and say, we have to lead in Iraq. But at some point, we're going to have to lead in Syria. If that 9 million figure, and that's the figure of internally displaced people and refugees that have left Syria for Turkey or Jordan or Iraq, if that figure becomes 10 or 11 and 12 million, and refugee experts believe it will, we're going to have to intervene in that crisis on a humanitarian basis, at the very least, to try to save some of the refugees. So we're going to have to assume American involvement here. Last point, we have to be fair to the president. There's no president of either party of the last 50 years, whom I know of, who could emerge from a couple of weeks of thinking about this, and it's really been several weeks where he's really, I think it's dawned on the administration, they have to lead, could emerge with a perfectly symmetrical, organized plan. FDR couldn't do it in the weeks after Pearl Harbor. It took us several months to constitute a British and American strategy to begin to fight back against Hitler in 1942. It's going to take a while. But if the president comes out tomorrow night and says, we have to be there, we have to lead, we have to continue the air power, but the Europeans have to be with us fighting, you know, with their air assets. And the Arabs, as Michael said, and I completely agree, need to work to dry up the financing for these Sunni jihadist groups within the United Arab Emirates and Saudi Arabia and Kuwait. That's a coalition that can work, but it's going to be very difficult to put together.
Michael, does any part of you listen to these analyses and say, no? You know, let's just let it go. You know, we'll say some good words about containment, drop some bombs when there's about to be a humanitarian crisis, but essentially not exercise this kind of aggressive leadership because it's too difficult to sell, too complex a sell, and possibly not sustainable over the medium term.
Well, if we'd enlarged this group of Kennedy School professors, we could have had my colleague and friend Steve Walt next here. And Steve is a wonderful guy. He says, walk away.
Yeah.
He's a realist, tough guy. I just don't think we can. I think for humanitarian reasons, but also for strategic reasons. And one unstated premise of this whole thing is the Chinese are getting a walk. The Russians are getting a walk. There's nobody left to go. And as Nick says quite rightly, the amount of leverage the United States has is decisively limited. The human rights issue that is an excruciating ethical dilemma, but a standard one, is the peace versus justice trade-off. I felt for a year that if I have to choose between the war going on in Syria and making some deal in Geneva 3 in which Assad holds what he has and various rebel groups hold what they have, and you have a stand-in-place ceasefire where the killing stops, I'll take it in a second. And notice how unjust and how horrible and excruciating that is. He's a really bad guy. He's as bad as everybody says he is. But I just think that's better than a lot more people dying. So the humanitarian action the United States has to take has to be connected to some political strategy that finally gets Assad to talk. And again, there, I think, again, all these choices are lousy. I think we actually have to really rattle his windows. That is, instead of taking the path of saying, well, the enemy of my enemy is my friend, you help us with ISIS and you stay, you actually do something different, which is you say, you have got to get back to the negotiating table and we've got to get to a partition ceasefire in Syria. That's the only way you can save your house. We're not going to work with you, we're not going to help you, but you must go back to Geneva, and if not, will regime target your...
My response to that is simply that it's a great idea, but it's not even slightly credible. I mean, if I were Assad,
well,
I would say...
I prefer...
I'm the moderate. I should shut up. Sorry.
No, you're doing a good job.
I prefer that to arming a bunch of rebels where you just simply know where... you don't know who you're dealing with.
Well, I agree with that, and I think what Assad's great advantage in this situation is that our alternatives are arming a groups of Syrian rebels. I mean, think of, you know, whom we might be thinking of here. You know, there's the Nusra Front, also formerly known as Al-Qaeda, who are our strategic allies against ISIS, de facto, right? There's Bashar himself, our strategic ally against ISIS. You know, we have not been able to threaten him enough to make him negotiate previously because we couldn't credibly say that we were prepared to remove the regime. And we really can't say it now when it looks like the removal of the regime would expand the reach for ISIS. You know, that would give them a good part of the Levant that they're seeking to get a piece of. So I worry with respect to all of the comments that you've made that they're completely reasonable and correct, but that we may not be able, this is the diplomatic version of Meghan's point about the military, that it's nice to say that we must do these things and it's quite never a matter actually to do them. Here, similarly, I'm not sure we can generate that kind of leverage on Assad. I think in practice he looks like a winner, and I think that means, just to turn to another topic, it means that Iran is a big winner here as well. But sorry, Nick,
one more quick point,
please, by all means.
And just to respond to what you said, because it's a very strong point, international politics is not static. We're not frozen in time. The president's major problem is that he's not taken seriously in the Middle East by authoritarian dictators, because when he drew the line and dared Assad to cross it, and Assad crossed it twice, the president punted to Congress. Yep. And it has really harmed the credibility of the United States. So I think a tough-minded realist might say, we've got to act militarily through the air in order to build back up that credibility to be able to do the things that I think the three of us have been talking about.
Though a tough-minded realist, when he drew a red line, might have felt that he had no choice but to bomb. I mean,
of course.
Yeah. So Iran. There is a read according to which, you know, from Iran's perspective, it's the best of times. It's the best of times, right? The United States' successive regimes have caused the Israelis at least not to use the military force that they like to threaten to use, or they have occasionally threatened to use. Negotiations exist. It was obviously a big problem for Iran that Bashar looked in danger of falling. Now, deus ex machina, they don't have to worry so much about that happening right away. What's your collective read on how things look for Iran over the next 3 to 5 years? And especially I'm interested in the nuclear question and Iran's public attitude towards Israel. Megan, you want to try that?
What, do you want to start?
We should go with Iraq and then I'll... Okay. Please.
No, please.
I might just have to call on somebody.
Actually, all right, I'll just start. But Megan knows 1,000 times more than I do about the impact of Iran and Iraq, and I think that's part of the answer to the question.
Part of the story,
so I'm not going to, Megan knows more than I do. I'm not going to touch that. I'll just say on the nuclear issue, I think President Obama has been very skillful. And I say that as President Bush's Iran negotiator from 05 to 08. What we have here is a Republican-Democratic consensus in the middle of the American political spectrum that it made no sense to resort to military force in 06 and 07 and 08, and George W. Bush chose diplomacy. And President Obama, Condi Rice had this image, you know, when a transition is when you just hand the baton off to the next administration. So a different president came in, adopted the same strategy as President Bush, has taken it, I think, brilliantly to not just a conclusion, but to the fact that we've leveraged the Iranians. We found that not just state-to-state sanctions, but financial sanctions would cripple, nearly cripple their economy. And those sanctions drove them to the negotiating table. And we've had a good deal of time now, well over a year, to get to know them. That was important because we hadn't had a serious discussion since 1979. I always thought, while I served in the Bush administration, that the idea that you go to war with a country that you hadn't talked to in 30 years was madness. And I think that President Bush was dedicated to diplomacy, President Obama is, and we'll know by November, December of this autumn whether or not that nuclear negotiation is going to work. If it works, President Obama will leave Iran short of a nuclear weapon, but with a civil nuclear program, the debate in this country and internationally will be what type of program, how big, how many centrifuges will be spinning. Jim Sabanias, Professor Sabanias of the business school, has done some very interesting work. He's a negotiations expert on this negotiation. If it fails, I don't think that we're going to go back to a war strategy. We might threaten the use of force, but it'll be in the American interest to restrain Israel, not to have Israel use force, probably to go back to a sanction strategy in order to get them back to the negotiating table in another stage of this multi-year negotiation. So I give credit to the president. It's his most important issue. I think in his mind, since he took office, this is his priority. I think he's got us in a good place. Not home yet, but in a strong and leveraging position.
Meghan, Iran in Iraq?
Yes, and I almost always agree with what you say on Iran. So I won't repeat anything because I generally think that President Obama has handled the Iran portfolio quite well as well. However, I grow increasingly skeptical about the prospects for a deal. Just looking at, there are a few issues that seem problematic, but certainly there's one issue that, and that's the issue of how much can the Iranians enrich under an agreement where the two sides seem to be very, very far apart, publicly very far apart. Squaring that circle, I think, is going to be a real challenge for American and Iranian diplomats. But I'd be hopeful. It's the one thing that I think can change Obama's image in the Middle East and America's image in the Middle East quite quickly. But let me just talk about Iran and sort of the calculation, Noah's question about, what's the balance for them? Are they winning on all fronts? Certainly it is. I would say it's largely true that what has happened in Iraq over the last 10 years has been, a boon to the Iranians, that they have ended up getting more influence in Baghdad probably than they ever envisioned. I would say, the first 6 years after the removal of Saddam or the rest of the Bush administration, there was this, if you were the Iraqi prime minister, you had to do a careful calibration of balancing Iranian interest and American interest, and that was often hard for these people to do. But, on more than one occasion, I would go into the house of an Iraqi politician only to realize the Iranian ambassador had just left the back door, so there was a lot of that going on. But, there was some sense of these are two very important external actors. And after our departure, our influence and our leverage, diminished greatly. And not just our leverage, but our influence and that of the Arab world. I think a big part of why the Iranians have been winners in Iraq is because the rest of the Arab world really decided not to embrace the Iraqi government for a range of reasons, most of them going to the factor that it's a Shia-dominated government, and that they felt that the current prime minister was a very sectarian actor, which he eventually, I would say, became. But, so there were no Saudis or even Turks, Jordanians, Emiratis to kind of balance the Iranian influence in Baghdad. I think, however, in the last few months, Iran actually is beginning to look at Iraq and think, actually, maybe this is not what we had in mind. ISIS was 20 miles from the Iranian border. So, it's all well and good for them maybe to be in Syria, but suddenly they're on the doorstep of the Iran the country of Iran. So that was deemed as deeply problematic from the Iranian perspective. And then secondly, and we may get to this elsewhere or in questions, there's a real question about whether Iraq is going to hang together and whether the Kurds are going to declare independence over, you know, I would say, the short to medium term or in the next couple of years. This will not be something that Iran looks upon as being helpful to them. They have a very substantial Kurdish population themselves, which borders on Iraqi Kurdistan. This will create new domestic problems inside of Iran. So, you know, as Nick said, this is fluid. This is, you know, there's always another chapter. I'll just say one word very shortly in case somebody wants to pick up on questions. I think also on the energy side, you know, when we do the calculation for Iran, we have to think about international energy markets and the energy exports that Iran is foregoing. And we know what's happened on the oil side with the sanctions, but we rarely think about the natural gas side. And Iran has maybe the second largest reserves of natural gas in the world. And they're hardly exporting any of that because they don't have the investment, they don't have the infrastructure, they don't have the markets, nobody will buy from them. And you know, they're missing the window where they would naturally grab a big part of the global gas markets. And my guess is, even if sanctions were lifted tomorrow, by the time they got all that investment and infrastructure going, you're going to have American exports on the market, Canadian, Australian, and the Iranians are probably going to have to wait another decade to seize that market. So I think on the energy side, there's not often a really good sense of this opportunity cost concept, but there's definitely an opportunity cost there.
I want to turn now to the other really major story, at least in the U.S. press and in the European press over this last year in the summer in the Middle East, and that is Israel and the latest iteration of the war in Gaza. And Michael, I want to start by asking you about, did you have the feeling, which I sometimes had during this summer, that we were in a kind of loop, you know, a kind of eternal return where, you know, we had seen this film before? And yet things didn't seem to be turning out in practical terms very differently from the way it had turned out previous times. I mean that only as an entree to ask you what your reactions and feelings have been about the summer's events.
Well, I was just in preparation for this. I phoned some friends in Tel Aviv and Jerusalem about this and talked to some other people on the other side. And I think a lot of Israelis were struck by the number of people who died on their side. The body count keeps creeping up. The interdiction of Tel Aviv Airport over the summer. The strategic surprise at the tunnels, I think it was a real shock to Israeli public opinion. And I think what I read from context inside Israel is the sense that you mow the grass, that infamous phrase, and you keep mowing it, and every time they come back, you bleed a little more, and your strategic position is not much more secure. And so I think just my sense of the people I talked to was a sense of a strategic paralysis, that it's, you can keep hitting Hamas at increasing and unbelievable collateral damage cost. And some of that collateral damage bothered a lot of Israelis morally and should. Some of it was just completely unacceptable. But the deeper question about the loop is we keep coming back. We're now in a cycle where every 2 or 3 years you go in and pound Hamas. And one question that Israeli friend put to me, which was unexpected since he's not a softie, but he said, you know, the thing that I find so hard to understand here is, you know, if it would be in Israel's strategic interest to drive as much of a wedge as possible between Hamas and Fatah, if the key here is to isolate and marginalize Hamas, if the key is also to get diplomatic movement forward so that Israel is not similarly isolated, if further both Fatah and Abu Mazen are in many ways alarmed by ISIS, Islamic fundamentalist terrorism on their flank, and therefore have a motive to begin to move towards Israel, you do begin to see that there was a window here for Netanyahu and Abu Mazen to do a deal that would have been enormously beneficial to two sides. What I look in retrospect now is some sense of real sorrow that the Kerry initiative didn't work. I don't know all the reasons why it didn't. I'm not privy to, I don't know anything about negotiations. We've got Jim Sabanius here. But clearly, a historic opportunity was missed that would have, had it been successful, reduced Israel's isolation, increased the separation, isolated Hamas still further, and I think in the context of the Middle East, been the right thing to do. And I just don't know when that train's coming back into the station.
Nicholas, do you have ideas about that question? Why the Kerry initiative was not ultimately successful?
Because neither Hamas nor Israel wanted the war to stop. And so Secretary Kerry, who put his heart and soul into that, was unfairly vilified by the Israelis, by the Israeli government and the Israeli press for what he tried to do. And I completely agree with Michael. I watched this and had so many conflicting emotions. And I use that word emotion. Because on the one hand, I just was jotting down my conclusions I thought that I came to. But they're all conflicting. Number one, Hamas emerged without a friend in the world because of its unbelievable cynicism in subjecting its civilian population to the bombing. And the fact that it broke every ceasefire before the Israelis did. Number two, the extraordinary tragedy of the Palestinian civilian population of Gaza. If you've been there, and I've not been to Gaza in years, probably since the 1990s, it's one of the most densely populated places on Earth. There's tremendous poverty. There's very little infrastructure. These people were prisoners of their horrible government, Hamas, and the Israeli Air Force. And as Michael said, I know the Israelis were defending their homes, and no one can question their right to defend their homes. And particularly when the tunnel system was exposed, defending literally their borders, I supported the right of the Israelis to hit back. But the use in the 21st century of precision-guided munitions, of munitions that hit schools and killed Palestinian kids, the Israelis have to think about that, the morality of it and the wisdom of it. Third, the Israelis need to make some kind of strategic move now. It can't be more settlements, but that's what they've just done. And I think if you're trying to separate Hamas from the Palestinian Authority, and if you're trying to build up Abu Mazen, you're going to cripple him politically by more settlements and absolutely zero movement on John Kerry's agenda for peace in the Middle East. Final reflection, and forgive this, but I was very involved in the 2006 war, basically talking to Israelis every day in the Israeli government when I was working for Condoleezza Rice. And the Israelis felt, when they got into the shooting war with Hezbollah in July of 2006, just give us some time and give us some rope, and we will deal a crippling blow to Hezbollah. And they couldn't do it. And the Israelis are left with this very cruel dichotomy. They are the strongest power in the Middle East, bar none, but they cannot defeat Hamas, and they cannot defeat Hezbollah. And as Michael said, all you're going to see periodically, but the gap is now, of course, narrowing. Instead of every 3 or 4 years, you might see it every 6 months. Rocket wars, where civilians on both sides are killed. At some point, the Israelis need to make a strategic, bold move for peace with the Palestinians.
Just to echo your description of the consequences of the 2006 war, I was in southern Lebanon in 2010, and there were signs everywhere with the heads of Hezbollah, kind of campaign signs, with the logo that said, what they say, they do. Now, that's an unusual slogan for an actual politician. It's a really good slogan. I mean, it requires you actually to have executed. And in the case of Hezbollah, by then they had fully rebuilt the homes, using primarily Iranian money, the homes that had been destroyed in the 2006 war. They had built them bigger and better, and their rocket capacity was substantially increased and is still, probably to a greater extent than before, embedded in the civilian population. So just as to even deepen the point that you're making about the strategic challenge from Israel's perspective, it's not just that they can't defeat Hezbollah and Hamas. It's that the consequences of these fights is that they actually strengthen Hezbollah and Hamas. And just one more thought about this. You mentioned that Hamas emerged with no strategic friend, and I agree with that. I actually think that Hamas, at a geopolitical level, is actually just as badly off as they were when they went into this, and is in desperate need of a reconciliation with Fatah for exactly that reason. But what they did get was a short-term and possibly longer-term as well boost in their popularity, both within Gaza, within the West Bank, and more broadly in the Arab world. Now, in the moment of the Arab Spring, the very brief moment of the Arab Spring, when it looked as though popular opinion might matter in Arab politics, that would have been a big plus for them. Now it's not anymore. We're back to the dictators, and so we're back to a traditional situation where it doesn't matter if ordinary Muslims or ordinary Arabic-speaking people are sympathetic to the Palestinian cause or to Hamas because they have no leverage over their own governments. Mm-hmm. But that said, you know, Hamas did gain real sympathy, and I think it's important to notice that. And the reason for that is that by surviving, it won. You know, if you fight a much more powerful force and you survive, that's not just a strategic
stalemate. By not losing.
Stalemate. Yeah. Exactly. It's not a stalemate. It's actually a victory.
Yeah.
This leads to the question of strategically what could be done. So do you think is there a picture in your mind, Meghan, of what kind of a strategic initiative Israel could make? I mean, leave aside the question of whether Netanyahu actually wants to do that or not, or whether his own political constituency would allow it, even if he did want to. But if you were just describing it in abstract terms, what would you imagine, or is there some picture that you could imagine that could look plausible?
Well, and of course, the answer has got to be yes. I mean, Nick finished on the note that Israel needs to take a big strategic initiative for peace, and I would agree with that. When you get into even the next layer of detail, it gets quite difficult, and even looking at the summer of the Middle East being really in flames in a way that it hasn't been even in the previous year, I still find this to be one of the hardest issues to think about what might be done, not only because, you know, in the other places, is there the political will? Here, it's what is the strategy that can be executed? What could that strategic initiative look like? And I would hope that my colleagues would add something. I have to, when I look at the picture, I at least think that a component of this has to do with economics and has to do with the rebuilding of Gaza. And just the enormous effort that that is going to take, and is there a way that that can be leveraged politically, that there's some kind of arrangement with the region where that rebuilding could be done in a way that changes the politics. I don't see this very clearly, but to me it seems like that might be where the opportunity is.
I mean, it's worth adding, too, that there are voices in the Israeli political spectrum who have the view precisely that this is not the time for any strategic initiative, who look at Hamas and say, well, how, you know, what is Hamas but just a few notches of the dial away from ISIS? And, you know, they can't be spoken to, and so we ought not to speak to them. I mean, and not only is that a view in the Israeli political spectrum, it's a view within Netanyahu's cabinet.
Right.
So, you know, that itself is a further powerful constraint on the situation.
We can't be prisoners of our own frameworks for peace. We've been assuming for 40, 50 years, Israelis, Americans, even Palestinians, that the peace is a comprehensive peace, that the historic land is divided, that Jerusalem is shared, et cetera, et cetera. You all know the issues. Maybe the strategic move that Prime Minister Netanyahu could make is not a complete peace. He can't get it with Hamas. They won't give it to him. It's a peace with Abu Mazen on the West Bank and in East Jerusalem. And to make peace with that majority segment of the Palestinian population that lives in the West Bank towns, all those big towns from Jenin and Tulkarm down to Hebron in the south. He is elderly, but he is constant and consistent that he wants this peace. He's willing to work for it. He is a partner. And the problem, but Professor Mnuchin is here, Professor Sabanias there, our partners on the project on negotiation, they're the experts. Isn't it better sometimes to negotiate when you're strongest? Israel's at its zenith. It won't be at its zenith 20 years from now relative to everything else happening in the Middle East. I think now is the time. Make a partial peace. Challenge Hamas with that partial peace.
I think that I could joyfully continue the conversation among the panel for the rest of the night, but I do want to give an opportunity to the audience to participate as well. So there are some microphones going around. If you'll raise your hands, I will point to you and a microphone will come to you in the center here. And my only request, the person in, just to the center, please. My only request is to keep your questions in the form of questions.
I have two related questions. Sorry, my name is Nancy. I'm a sophomore at the college. My first is, what was the potential of Hamas and Fatah's coalition at the beginning of the summer, which fell apart after the kidnapping of Eyal, Gilad, and Naftali? And my second question is, isn't it possible that Netanyahu isn't directly interested in peace? After all, peace tends to elect the left in Israel, and violence and partisanship tends to elect the right, and Likud and Habat Yehudi are certainly not the left.
I just say very quickly, I think that the Hamas-Fatah deal at the beginning of the summer was window dressing. It was superficial. It was political. And you saw that what happened during the rocket war is that Abu Mazen was being built up by the Egyptians and the Israelis to be the preferred Palestinian to negotiate with. And if you read the newspaper, I mean, there was stuff in the newspaper the last 24 hours that they're pulling apart. It's not a serious coalition. There's too many differences between them. The Palestinian Authority is responsible and dedicated to peace, and Hamas is neither of those two things. And I guess I'd say, Nora, just briefly on your second question, I have a lot of sympathy for Prime Minister Netanyahu. I do. If ISIS was bearing down on Israel, and it is, ISIS is in villages in Jordan, and the Prime Minister's given some speeches recently saying this now has to be the major threat, he may not have the political consensus in his own party or coalition to move ahead. So I'm just arguing about the complexity of all this. I want a strategic move for peace, but I can see, if you put yourself in the shoes of the Prime Minister, how difficult it is because of the ISIS question.
I would just, can I, please, go ahead.
Just very shortly on that question of how difficult it would be in terms of his own coalition, that raises the question of, is there another coalition that he could put together? And I think that there is. I mean, there is a coalition where you could have Likud and Labor and Shas. And so I would say that he does have other ways of rising to this moment. And the Jordan point is not a small one. I mean, that's potentially the next chapter of this ISIS story, which will really bring in Israel in a very substantial way, is if you start to get real elements, nodes, activity of ISIS in Jordan. And I think that's, you know, not even remotely difficult to imagine, but I cut
you off. I just wanted to say, I'm not completely convinced that I agree, Nick, that the pre-war coalition was not deep at all. And I agree
Hamas
that it was, yes, yeah. And I agree that it was politically driven. Yeah. But I think it was politically driven by Hamas's extreme weakness. I think Hamas was feeling so weak that they needed the coalition to get themselves more resources and cover, and that they were actually prepared to make some substantial concessions to do that. I think that was threatening to Netanyahu. I think that coalition would have been of concern to him. That's was stated openly by him, so that's not a great secret. But I think that the war actually was an effective tool for breaking that coalition and thereby making it much less likely that there could be negotiations in which Hamas would appear as a kind of shadow player. Negotiations with Abu Mazen in which Hamas stood in the background and was prepared to acquiesce in practice, if not in word, to a deal. Since I'm someone who thinks that it's be very difficult or impossible for a Palestinian leader to do a deal just in the West Bank, I liked the possibility of a kind of shadow Hamas participation. But I think the prospect of that is basically gone, and for the reasons that you say. The relationship was too weak, and the rest of the Arab world doesn't want that relationship. I think that's clearly the case. Yes, please, over here.
Hello, my name is Philip Gardner. I'm a master's student at the Center for Middle Eastern Studies. If we look at all the issues that were raised in relation to Iraq and Syria and right across the region, there was a lot of sympathy expressed for President Obama, but it does seem that it all comes down to one issue when it comes to US policy in the region. And that is, he is perceived as someone who will do almost anything to avoid getting involved in the Middle East, perhaps because he believes the United States won't do good there in their involvement. So is it not the case that that apparent aversion to doing anything, no matter what happens, is what really undermines his attempts to rhetorically shape the behavior of the actors in the region?
Michael, you want to take that?
So we get lots of time for questions. I simply parse again what my colleague and friend Nick Burns said a minute ago, which is that the president suffered very serious reduction in his credibility with the Red Line episode in September. My view also, however, is that this is not irrecuperable, and let's not personalize it to Obama. The United States is the only power with the military capacity, the diplomatic network, to have any leverage in the region. We've not mentioned the possibility of Russian leverage in relation to Syria, and it is a significant silence in this story that we haven't got any great power partner there with whom jointly you could apply leverage. And that's, I think, one of the significant aspects of this story that we haven't discussed. But I think it's important not to personalize it to the president, and I think it's important to remember the enormous capabilities of the United States. And for me, the key issue is to start leaning on the Gulf states and the Saudis and just tough stuff. And then also some other partners.
Meghan, you were a very senior advisor to Governor Romney in his presidential run. Would you like to personalize it to the president for us?
I'll do it with a soft touch. I do think that President Obama, this may be overstating it, but kind of had two assumptions that guided a lot of his policy in the Middle East, or two kind of foundational points, which he and his advisors returned to time and time again when the situation in the Middle East seemed to call for more robust American action. I mean, first is what Michael mentioned, the notion that President Obama was elected to get the United States out of the Middle East. And the real irony, and I think what has been part of this reassessment, is the reality that President Obama has done exactly what he thought the American people wanted him to do in the Middle East, yet his approval ratings on foreign policy are very, very low. And I think that leads, you know, at least some of us to think, well, there's never a time when Americans are like, let's go for a war. You know, there's never the desire to get involved in the Middle East or anywhere else. And it falls to our leadership, it falls to our president to make the case. And so the problem is that when the world calls for American action, or it is in the interest of the United States to take American action, and we don't have the leadership articulating that our interests are at stake. And I think just going back to how the Iraq action was presented to us, which I was very supportive of President Obama's actions, but I was concerned that he presented it to the nation largely in a humanitarian lens. The first actions we took in Iraq, the actions we took a couple days, most of the actions we've taken in Iraq have not been motivated on a humanitarian basis. Most of them have been strategic. We have real strategic interests in Iraq and that part of the world, and I'd like to see a president who will articulate those interests to the American people, because it's only that way, and hopefully we will see this tomorrow night, it's only that way that he is going to be able to have the support of the American people to do something which is going to be against our desires and our instinct. Sorry to go on too long. The second assumption I think that has had to be revised is a real lesson I think that many Americans took away from the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, and that was that, you know, no matter how hard we try, we don't really have the ability to affect what happens in the Middle East. And my personal view is that's not a correct reading of the situation in Iraq and Afghanistan. I think we did many things wrong in both of those places, made mistakes, probably made the situation, a very difficult situation, even harder than it needed to be. But I don't walk away from that period in history saying our action in the Middle East, the steps that we might take, military, diplomatic, economic, and otherwise, is meaningless. And so, and I do think that the president has had to reevaluate that, that idea that actually what we do is not of consequence or significance because, you know, clearly it is, even just the last 2 months. But these are two things that I think, as from President Obama's perspective, you know, they really guided his thinking on policy in the Middle East. And the events of the last few months have been so dire that, you know, he's had to look at them again. And I actually I'm fully supportive of where I think he's going.
But Meghan, can I just push back for one moment on that? I mean, they haven't been meaningless. They've had American actions in the region have had major consequences. They also haven't gone well. I mean, if we take on board the ultimate outcome and we consider not just our intentions, but also our capacities, our domestic political capacities to sustain, you know, the real world constraints.
Right.
You know, I mean, it's very difficult, not impossible, but very difficult to argue that the situation in Iraq, say, is substantially better now than it would have been in a had we waited for Saddam to give way to a revolutionary, you know, domestic movement, which I think almost certainly would have happened in the Arab Spring in some form. Now, you could say there would never have been an Arab Spring if it were, one can play out the hypotheticals. But all I'm saying is, ultimately, to me, the ethical test and the real foreign policy test of the worthwhileness of American interventions is, are people plausibly better off now in the region than they were previously, and are our interests better off? And it's very far from clear to me that either of those is true.
No, I don't want to delve into that great substance here, but I think
next year's seminar.
What you are saying is correct. If you look at the Iraq experience, and you look at what our country put into Iraq, what others put into Iraq, and you look at the outcome. But what I'm saying is to extrapolate from that experience to say that pretty much any sort of intervention beyond very minuscule amounts of economic aid and lots of rhetoric, you know, you're really extrapolating big from going from, okay, we shouldn't do a large ground war to remove hostile dictators and then occupy a traumatized Arab country, to we should make speeches and not have a lot of follow-up. I mean, really, I think, you know, maybe I'm being unfair.
Well, we did remove another Arab dictator. Obama did remove another Arab dictator using air power. I mean, he did do that, for better or worse.
Yeah,
not how well that went. Well,
and would have he done that on his own without the European push for that? I think that's pretty debatable as well. And was he comfortable doing that and then taking on the natural consequence of those actions? I mean, today we're looking at, we're not even talking about Libya.
Right.
But Libya is a huge problem. And again, this was fairly anticipatable just simply because of what we actually learned from Iraq and Afghanistan.
Just one interjection, Noah, I could, because I want to support what Meghan is saying. One of the problems here is that we all, as Americans, in the wake of Iraq and Afghanistan, may have overlearned the lessons. If we're paralyzed, if we think that we can't do anything positive or effective in the Middle East, then we give up our interests. And that is not tolerable for the United States. In recent memory, the last 20 years, President George H.W. Bush and James Baker put together a brilliant coalition that dislodged Saddam Hussein from Kuwait. And take it further, over the last 50 years, we have protected the Gulf states. We've kept the Persian Gulf open for shipping. We've ensured the export of oil and gas from the Middle East. We've built up Israel and protected Israel. And we've been a good friend to a lot of the Arab states of North Africa and Levant. So I think if you overlearn the lessons and pull back so much from the throttle of leadership that we think we can't do good anymore, or at least be effective, that's the wrong lesson to learn.
Hi, this is Sahar al-Bazar. I'm a student in HKS, mid-career MPA. I have two questions regarding ISIS. The first question is, in your opinion, what are the reasons behind their existence in the region at that point of time? The second question, do you think that they are supported financially from another countries? And if yes, which countries do you think they are supporting them?
Very good questions.
Take a stab at it. Thank you very much. We could organize an entire course at the Kennedy School around your two questions. Maybe we should. And they're difficult. Certainly, if the Sunni population in Iraq, if it feels disenfranchised, if it feels powerless, if it feels that the Baghdad government was closed to them, then it fuels resentment. And it helps to fuel the Sunni-Shia divide that is underneath and surrounding this entire conflict in both Iraq and Syria. So obviously the smart policy, and again, Meghan is the expert here, and she should speak to this, is can we now carry out with the new Iraqi government a variation of what General Petraeus, President Bush, carried out in 2007 and 8, win back the Sunni tribes of Anbar province of the western part of Iraq, turn them away from ISIS. That is, I think, something that we've got to do. And so that's how I'd answer your very good question. On the question of funding, Michael has hit the nail on the head. I don't know what the government of Qatar is doing in all respects, but I suspect a lot of their funding is not going to virtuous groups. And certainly individuals in Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, the Emirates, Oman, are helping to fund ISIS. And then Michael's made the point that we need to lean on those governments to try to cut the funding off. Please.
Just very, very briefly, I agree with Nick on the points about the ISIS in Iraq and the specific alienation of the Sunnis there. I would just maybe add to that, broadening out the point a little bit, that a big part of the crisis in the Middle East, which not only manifests itself in ISIS, but in some of the other crisis dysfunction we're seeing, is just the failure of the centralized state in large parts of the Arab world. You know, the failure of the state to actually deliver to citizens, to deliver to them economically, in some cases educationally, but really the failure to deliver opportunities for a better future. And so when I think about, and so this ends up playing out in Syria in a certain way, ends up playing out in Iraq in a certain way, and creates a space. And it's not a Sunni space, necessarily an ISIS space, but it's a crisis, I think, that's affecting broad swaths of the Arab world, and I think it is like one of the really big challenges here. And I think one of the interesting issues, certainly for Syria and for Iraq, I hope the time frame in which they will be tackled will be short, but it may be longer, has to do with, you know, is there a role for federal states in the Arab world beyond the United Arab Emirates? And I, you know, here we could defer to Noah here on this question of kind of the whole constitutionalism, but I think, you know, there was a new Iraqi government announced and voted on and formed on Monday, so yesterday. A lot of people are kind of declaring victory. And to me, I think like, well, you know, there's some interesting things about that government, but the first thing is, okay, that's just like, that's step one of 2,000 steps. And you know, maybe the next 300 steps have to do with renegotiating the nature of the state away from a de facto centralized Arab part of the state to a more federal one. So I kind of see it, you know, as the crisis of the centralized state.
I would also just add very briefly that ISIS is also self-funding now. So yeah. Quite apart from the funding, they've been extraordinarily effective, both in the exercise of sovereignty within territories and also in just picking up cash where it was sitting in Mosul and elsewhere. So they're remarkably, probably more effectively self-funding than any other comparable group that we've seen. In the very far back corner here.
Hi, my name's Aaron. I'm a college freshman. Even if the Hamas-Fatah reconciliation attempt was politically driven, doesn't the very fact that Abu Mazen was willing to reconcile with an organization that preaches hatred of Israel kind of invalidate Abu Mazen as a partner for peace?
But you
answer this.
Look, we're not talking about saints. We're talking about a situation of poisonous distrust. But we're also talking about a man, Abu Mazen, who I think over a very long period of time has taken some personal risks to establish himself as a credible partner for peace. Let's not overdo his capacity to deliver. Let's not underestimate the divisions within Fatah. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. But if in the wake of the collapse of the Kerry Peace Initiative, he makes a political deal with Hamas, I don't think that invalidates his potential in the future as a partner for peace. And I also think, again, it's absolutely critical to the security of Israel to find a partner in the West Bank that they can do business with and do business quickly. The house is on fire here. The region is on fire. And if ISIS is in Jordan, it's right next door. The one thing you can say about the ISIS phenomenon is that it's concentrating the minds. There are worse things than, you know, the Arab-Israeli conflict. The worst thing is the total collapse of order in the entire region. At that point, you think, this gives us an opportunity. If we're both threatened by the collapse of order in a region, let's do some business.
I was actually calling on her just here. Just right here.
Hi, my name is Brooke. I'm a senior at the college. Professor Burns, you mentioned that a UK American French coalition is not enough to combat ISIS. And you mentioned Iran in that discussion as sort of an adversary. And Professor O'Sullivan, you talked about the immense influence that Iran has had in Iraq over the past few years. And so, you know, I'm wondering if America is going to lead some sort of successful effort to combat ISIS, does that not mean that realistically we must confer with Iran on some level when Iran especially has such an interest in combating ISIS itself?
Or are we already doing it?
When President Obama was in Wales last week at the NATO summit, the White House made a big deal about the fact that I think 11 of the NATO allies had said, we'll be with you, which was a good thing. The problem was it was incomplete. And the president is moving very quickly here. He's leaning, as Michael said, on the Gulf Arab states to be part of this coalition, meaning to be part of it, to fight with us through the air. And that's the right thing. We don't have the credibility in Western Europe and North America, Canada, the United States, to lead a coalition against ISIS. It has to have buy-in from the Sunni Arab states. And so the president is doing all this, and he'll mention this tomorrow night. On the question of Iran, I guess I'd say this. I've long been a proponent of talking to the Iranians. And by the way, it was Yitzhak Rabin who said in 1993, you don't negotiate with your best friends. You negotiate with very unsavory enemies. Abu Mazen's not an enemy. He's a man of peace. But the Iranians have been adversaries. I guess that'd be, they're not an enemy, but they're an adversary. We should talk to them. We should share information. We should have a dialogue, but we should not align ourselves with them, and we shouldn't help them. There's a difference in diplomacy between the two. It just seems to cripple yourself if your position is, I won't talk to anybody I don't like, then you blind yourself as a strategist, as a negotiator. But if you have the view, I'll talk to anybody who will make us smarter, but I only align with people we believe in, that's different. I think I'd make that distinction, Brooke, between on the Iran question. Talk, yes. Align, no. Not yet. They're still shooting at us. They're still making life difficult for the United States and Israel through their support of terrorist groups in the Middle East. We shouldn't give them that yet. But it's a very good question about how you negotiate. And I don't know if Professor Mnookin or Professor Sabanias want to chime in, but they're the real experts here on how you play a negotiation like this.
But I have to say, I would say more cynically that we are already doing this. I mean, we have Iranian-backed militias participating with Iraqi forces, and we are coordinating with those Iraqi forces. So de facto, we are coordinating with Iran so far. I think that's an undiplomatic way to put it, but I think it does also capture some aspects of the reality as it's being exercised. I mean, when Nick says very eloquently that in diplomacy there's a difference between alliance and coordination, or alliance
aligning.
Aligning, that's exactly right. There is a difference in diplomacy between those two things. But that's not the same as there being a difference in reality between those two things.
Now, Nora, you're not saying that diplomacy is not reality, are you?
I'm saying diplomacy is it's a kind of very valuable and important meta-reality. yes, sir, right here.
We talked about the growth of ISIS and their military gains. My question is about the impact of ISIS ideology on the cultural and moral values in the West. To me,
in the West. In the West.
Okay. To me, ISIS ideology is an Ebola. I mean, with respect to their human rights, we saw a massacre of two soldiers, horrible. But actually, there were not two, there were four. There were two other Lebanese. But the media did not mention that. Mm-hmm. There were 600 people who were executed in one day, thrown in the river. There is a call for female genital mutilation. These are all things, okay, in matter of psychology that the media is not paying attention to. And my feeling, my question is, do you believe that we can live and let this Ebola ideology live? Thank you.
It's a great question. I think one of the things that we have to understand is we're dealing with this is an enemy, not an adversary, an enemy with an absolute mastery of 21st century social media, an absolute mastery of the propaganda of atrocity, and a deep strategic understanding of the military uses of atrocity. If you engage in these barbaric acts, it makes it much easier to control swaths of territory with small numbers of people. If you are extreme in everything you do, it has a military and strategic value. It's abominable, it's disgusting, but it's extremely effective. The aspect of the battle against the values that concerns everybody is the percolation of these, the values expressed by those acts into Western Europe and North America. And the number of citizens of my country, for example, and citizens of countries here who've been lured into battle is a phenomenon that we need to understand. But we need to understand, it's one of these cases where moral outrage sometimes can block your analytical understanding. I mean, I think, for example, just to take a tiny example, the fact that the person who did the beheading of the hostage was from South London in England, I think is fairly easily explicable. That is, if you arrive, you're an outsider in ISIS, and you're immediately given a chance to prove that you're the worst of the worst. You seize that opportunity. It's a kind of initiation ritual for that awful, psychotic person. It binds him to the organization. It's extremely useful to the organization because he's speaking colloquial English. And we have to understand this, in other words, in a strategic dimension. The moral disgust that we feel is only the beginning of the challenge, which is to understand exactly how this stuff works and be unafraid, to be unintimidated by it, and then to develop those strategies. Some of them are simply counterinsurgent, counterterrorism strategies domestically at home, and then think very hard about a very big, disturbing question, which is why it is that anybody in a liberal democracy with full rights could conceivably be attracted to this form of infamy. This is a challenge to our societies. And we shouldn't lose sleep over it. I don't regard the fact that 200 Westerners join this bunch of fanatics as an indictment of the United Kingdom or Canada. But it is a problem. We need to think hard about why this trail of infamy leads right back to our neighborhoods. Doesn't frighten me. We shouldn't be frightened of it. But we need deeply to understand why it even becomes possible.
We have time for two more questions. Just here in the center. Yes, you. No, just behind you, sir. Yeah.
Hello, my name is Wright. I'm a sophomore at the college. My question is, you talked about the cost to Iran in its involvement in Iraq, the costs and the benefits. I was wondering if you could touch on the costs and benefits to Iran and Hezbollah for their influence in Syria, whether they've gained anything beyond just propping up the Assad regime, and what does that cost them?
Okay.
Well, I think in terms of looking at what Iran has at stake in Syria, it is the story's maybe a little bit less about what they're gaining versus what they're trying not to lose. And so that's more how I look at it. They're staving off something that would be considered a defeat. Not only would it be a psychological and a strategic and a political defeat, but it also would have practical purposes in the sense of the land bridge into the Levant. And I think that's part of the reason why there has been such an emphasis on Syria and why Iran has you know, invested so much in propping up Assad. There are other elements we can look at. The other day I was looking into the question of actually there's quite a lot of Iranian oil going to Assad. It doesn't appear that they're getting paid for it. So in some ways, that doesn't seem like much of a benefit to give away your oil for free. But you know, there's undoubtedly some economic linkages there that we're probably not aware of that may have some mitigating effect on the sanctions. But I would say it's more what Iran has not lost rather than what Iran has gained.
I would just add, we can't underestimate the impact of the Shia-Sunni rivalry now. And the Iranians clearly working with Hezbollah are fueled by that. And working with someone, a leader, Assad, who's very sympathetic to the Shia strategic cause in the Middle East. I think that does fuel this.
The person who was sitting just in front of the person who asked the last question. She will get the last question.
Okay, so, all right. Hi, I'm Lee Moore from the college as well. So I wanted to ask two questions about coming back to Israel. First of all, in terms of the coalition that fell between Hamas and Fatah that we already mentioned, do you think the Israeli response was accurate or appropriate? And how much involvement does that have in the conflict that we eventually have seen during the summer, if you think there is any? And the second one, in terms of Abu Mazen being a partner for peace, what kind of assurances does the Israeli government has that he's actually capable of having this kind of process going through, specifically after the Oslo agreement that we know has failed and caused potentially some kind of surge of violence in the region?
Great questions. Everyone's free to weigh in on these and anything else. These can also be they can double as your concluding remarks.
Well, I'll just combine your two questions. They're really good questions. And they're hard. They're hard questions to answer because they require a lot of thought. It's a complex situation, but here goes. I think Abu Mazen has demonstrated for the last 20 years he's a man of peace. Because you have to judge him in his own community, in his own political spectrum. He clearly stands for that. He's taken risks for that. He's stood for negotiations when it hurt him politically in the West Bank, not just in Gaza, with Hamas. And the Israelis don't have a lot of choices here. I thought it was not skillful of Prime Minister Netanyahu to reject the Hamas-Fatah coalition. I didn't think it played to Israel's long-term interests because I don't think the Israelis can win here a military victory over Hamas, as we've said before. At some point, you have to turn towards a strategic decision for peace. It's what made Rabin such a great leader in 1994 and 1995. He took an enormous risk. And that gets to your very good second question. No guarantees here. There are risks involved in peacemaking. Sadat and Begin took risks in March of 1979. Begin took enormous risks. The Israelis had just fought the Egyptians in a series of wars going back to 1948, and yet Begin took this enormous leap of faith that Sadat was going to be different. I think Abu Mazen is one is such a person. And if you don't start now, I do think if you look at the sociology of the West Bank and the embittered population in Gaza and the West Bank, you will have a more radical generation coming up behind Abu Mazen. Israel will be relatively weaker 20 years from now, with a more recalcitrant population, and they'll be occupying them, denying the democratic fabric of Israel itself. You know, from an outsider's perspective, I'm not an Israeli politician, obviously, now's the time to make that leap towards peace. And since this is the last thing I say, I wanted to thank the Riesman family and thank Hillel. It's been a fascinating conversation, and you've been a pretty good moderator. You challenged us. Thank you, Noah.
Megan, Michael? Good.
I think that's a good note on which to end, from my perspective.
I'd just like to underscore one thing in conclusion. I agree with everything that Nick said in response to these questions, but I also think the questions that are skeptical about who's a partner for peace are exactly the right questions. And nobody from this audience thinks that anybody who is a partner for peace gets a free pass. This is a bloody, mistrustful, difficult story in which everybody comes to the table with histories of hatred, histories of hurt, histories of poignant loss on both sides that make any deal difficult in the best of circumstances. And I think everybody at Emerson 105 is aware that what we counsel from zones of safety has little purchase on those who are in zones of danger. And Israel is in a zone of danger. And you just, so I think everybody feels a kind of modesty about this. You know, it's tough living in that neighborhood. And you know, that has to be acknowledged. I think another thing that Megan said earlier and Nick said, which I want to emphasize, is that I think the United States is in the middle of a very difficult reevaluation of its role in the world consequent upon Iraq. I mean, there have been two traumatic experiences of American failure in my lifetime. One was Vietnam, and one was Iraq. And they were very traumatic, and they're traumatic for all of us in this room. And part of the challenge about thinking about the Middle East is to learn from the lessons of failure. And what are the lessons of failure? Clearly, invading a large and proud Arab country with a lot of troops and trying in a very short period of time to build stable institutions and then coming home didn't work very well at all. But the alternative, as Megan said, which is to give a lot of speeches and walk away, seems to me to draw the wrong lesson from failure. And so we're all struggling to find out what the right lesson of failure is. There's simply no alternative to the deepening downward spiral of chaos and disorder in the region, but some form of rational, restrained, modest, focused, disciplined, and perseverant action by the United States. And we're all sitting here trying to think about what that should be. But an emphasis on modesty, humility, perseverance, patience, determination, and above all, knowledge of the places we're involved in seems to me the test of what we're looking for, and we're looking for it in the president's speech tomorrow night. Thank you.
I just want to thank both the audience and the panelists. To my mind, this was a model of a rational, thoughtful, and engaged discussion on topics that are challenging, that are difficult, that are intensely felt. And that's what we're here in the university for. And I'm very grateful to the Riesmans, the Burmans for sponsoring the event in honor of the Riesmans, and to all of you very much for coming. Thank you.